time, bro.
So I'm Olivier. I've been scoring games for about 15 years now. Some of the games you might know about, but we don't care much about this right now. What we do care is about music for games that is more than just music. So it's a title because basically what I want to do is to take you on a journey, okay? And the journey to the unknown, okay? Something that nobody knows about. Do you know that nobody knows how to make a game? You know, that's something that you should know. Nobody knows how to make a game. So how would you know how to make music for games if they don't even know what they're doing? Yeah, no, that, it's a real question. Don't laugh. So let's embark into my ship, the WW-15E. And we'll go together from Earth to explore the first world where most people just, you know, the ship stays there forever, and I've made a game lately called 1111 Memories Retold. And then we'll go a little further in space where I did like Vampire, doing something that few people understand. We'll see how much here. And finally, we'll go out of, you know, space to this planet where I did Get Even, and I came back alive. So before going through those games and the different approaches, I would like first to talk about the relationship between a composer and a developer. It's very important, actually, this is key. Then I want to talk about the approach, general approach. Finally, why bother, you know, why? Let's see. So before starting, I want to talk about something that that is very critical, in my opinion. It's like there are a lot of misunderstandings. So what is music for games? If you ask people, music for games is what? So the general assumption, like the general public, will be like this. Like, oh yeah, Mario, Zelda, I don't know, The Last of Us, you know. They're not, I mean, they know the music, and the music might be great or not. We don't, I mean, it doesn't matter much. It's about the games, okay? People first relate on the games, and then the music that, you know, was on the game. So basically, they think, you know, of the game rather than the music. Then you have nowadays a lot of soundtracks. You know, vinyl is the trend right now, okay? And people are very excited about this. You can also have Spotify and, you know, iTunes, everything. Finally, you have concerts. Concerts music with, you know, music from video games, which is great or not, you know, depending how you want to think about music for games. But is this music for games? You know, the general assumption is like, oh yeah, well, that's what they think it is, but we're professionals, okay? So let's see on our end, what is music for games? And let's start with composers. So for a composer, music for games is usually writing music. You know, this is what people think it is, to write music for games. It's like, oh yeah, I write music, and then it's on a game, then I'm scoring a game. I've done a music for game. What is it for the developer? Well, it's a WAV file. Hey, don't laugh. It's real. You guys, composers, are just a WAV file for most composers, for most developers. You're not even human. So, the misunderstanding for a composer generally is that they feel that, because of interactivity, they won't be expressing their own music. That's one of the biggest misunderstanding, you know? Like composers would be like, I don't know about interactive music. It's forcing me to do things, and now I can't express myself. I do not understand this sort of, you know, mindset, because they are scoring something. And what they are scoring is a form, okay? Like a symphony is, a concerto is, with constraints. And you need, as a creative person, to use the constraints to be even more creative. You know what I mean? So actually, it's a blessing to have some limitations, because it will push you into new, you know, ways of being creative. And then the developer, the big misunderstanding is that they don't take you, when you're a composer, as part of the team. They don't see you as a team, let's say, component. You're just like a service, okay? So picture this, you're a WAV file and you don't want to adapt to their need, you know? So that's some of the misunderstandings. Let's just see the general approach now. So that's like a good shake, you know, handshake. And you have on one hand, the relationship is the service provider, a composer, you guys, okay? And on the other hand, you have the client with a product to ship, like the video game, okay? And that's the relationship that is for more than 90% of the games out there, I guess. I mean, you would have like a lot of composers telling you this is the way it works, okay? And that's the problem. It's proven to be very efficient. Look at you guys, when you think about music for games, although the relationship was like that, most of the time you did enjoy both, maybe the game and the music. So it's very efficient, so it's very difficult for somebody like me to sort of say, yeah, we can do better. Why do better if it's already efficient, okay? So the one thing that we need to understand, and that's one of the, you know, it's based on misunderstandings, of course. The biggest misunderstanding today, because we're talking about, you know, Audiokinetic and WISE, is this. How do you envision WISE as a composer? What do you think of WISE? Well, basically, most people will see it as a music player. Play, stop, you know, do like this sort of rule, whatever, you know, like exploration music, go to fight music, transition. It's just a player, okay? Well, WISE is not just a player. WISE is an audio engine for music. It's an engine. So I don't know how much you realize what it means, so I'm gonna try to explain a little bit what it means. But basically, if you want to be very clear, this is Clark Kent, and this is Superman. That's very, now you understand, okay? So me, when I'm looking at most, you know, composers or developers using WISE, I'm like, I don't understand why you keep those glasses on. You have superpowers. And they're like, yeah, you know, I have Lois Lane, blah, blah, blah. So anyways, so now, let's just, now you know the misunderstanding, okay? I'm not gonna go like deep inside this. Let's go back to, yeah, and the thing is like, since it's an engine, it's more open to creativity, you know, you understand why. So let's go back to the relationship. So let's pretend, you know, that me and the developer, so that's the developer, and you, let's say the composer, you're out there, you know, in the unknown, and you want to do something, okay, about this, about video games. You want to do more than just, oh, give me a WAV file, I'll put this into the game, I will be, you know, using WISE as a player, depending on little states, and it will make the music interactive, and you'll get, like, if the game is a big success, you'll get to have a soundtrack and do concerts, and we're all happy, which is basically the success story you're gonna have out there. So what do they need to do, both of them? You know, basically, so it's gonna be a little, like, complicated, it's like, envision together the game through a musical spectrum. Okay, feels like I'm a philosopher now, but the thing is, what people tend to do with music is to think it's one component of, you know, most, like, tons of other components. Okay, like audio. Let's say they say, oh, we need sound effects, we need, I don't know, voiceover, and we need music, and people see them as layers, like sound effect, music, you know, and voiceover thing. But it's not. We all know it's not. It's just one direction. Audio is just one thing, because you can't hear more than just one or two things like to focus on. Okay, so it's very important to envision this as one thing. And it's the same when you talk about music in a game. You want to see music on over the whole experience of the game, not like, oh, I need music here because it feels weak, like nothing much happened. And so you need to share a vision. So this is when it gets a little weirder for people I work with, okay? And I have this video that shows you a little bit how I try to convince them to have a different approach than the general approach. So let's see this. So this is me. So I'm looking at my vision of what I can do on this game.
Look at it. It's all ours.
Yeah.
From the mountains.
So that's...
to the oceans.
That's the developer, okay, the receiver. And this is what they look at when I talk. You know, that's less...
What am I looking for exactly?
Yeah, what am I looking for exactly? They start doubting about what I'm saying, okay?
You'll see. Just close your eyes. But keep your mind wide open.
Now, you know, it's even more difficult. But, look at this. Look, that's very important. That's the big effort. And look the result. There was no waterfall. They saw that I didn't do it.
Wow.
Yeah, you got it. Congrats. All right. So basically, you need to understand. I mean, okay, it's funny and things, but it happened on every game I worked on. Every game, people were like, what? I was like, yeah, we can do that. Like this. And can we do this? Yeah. And this? Yeah. And if I say this, yeah, we can do this. And they start being like excited about, you know, how to use music in a different way than just like, there is a background music that is either beautiful or terrible. Who cares? You know, it's about, you know, how you're going to use the music. So basically, it requires a big effort on both sides, because it starts with you guys, composers. We need to know more about what most composers in this industry right now know about. Is it English? Yeah. So let's talk a little bit now about the approach, the general approach. So basically, you know, when somebody will want to, oh boy, okay, we want to work on a game, most composers, what they do, they're like, yeah, tell me about the story, tell me about the world. So okay, we can talk about the story and the world. Then they're like, oh, do we want like thematic music, something that, you know, has like melodies or whatever textures that come back and make some themes? Then do you have cutscenes? So, you know, already it starts to become a little bit technical, but let's just assume that cutscenes now is very casual. Everybody knows about that. Next is like, oh, do we want to pre-render files or to, I mean, so we'll see what's the other possibility. And finally, is it scripted? Meaning that, oh, do you have control over the music throughout the experience? If a composer goes like on the three first, you know, steps here, this is like the top maximum of involvement from a composer, usually. You know, usually it's like, okay, that's it. Give me some videos. I will write the music. You want some stems. You want like separate tracks and you want, you know, yes, of course they will provide this to you because they are what? They're a service provider. Remember? You know, it's just this. It's just like a WAV file. Here's for you. Okay, but now what you need to do, if you want to sort of, you know, gather with the developer and to understand what is this game about for real and to score the game for what the game is. What is a game, by the way? Do you know, guys, what is a game? Any ideas? Like, I'm sorry? Yeah, well, okay, but, you know, what makes a game? You know, if you speak about the movie, you know, the core of a movie, what is the core of a movie? Yeah, the script, okay? The script. Okay, what is it for a game? The gameplay, yes. The gameplay. So that's so funny that composers would be like, hey, what's the story? Is it a movie? No, it's a game. Okay, what are you talking about? They should start with, what is the gameplay? Okay, so let's do it. And the story, the world, and the gameplay. Because depending on the gameplay, the writing will be different. Why? Let's say the gameplay is very reactive, something that is so like fast in pacing that you know as a composer that you can't have like a long theme, let's say like something that is 20 seconds, because you know that the game needs to react to a faster pace. So you think, okay, I can't have that in the game. Constraints. How can I go around and create something that is still entertaining, you know, in my writing and meaningful? So the next thing, of course, thematic music and systemic music. So systemic music, what does it mean? You guys should know about this, systemic. Everything in a video game is systemic. Do you think they start like a game saying like, oh yeah, we're gonna do this and this and this and this and this and this and so on? No, they just do like, oh, let's try to make this gameplay mechanic. And once we get this right, we repeat this forever and ever. That's a gameplay loop, you know? This is how they call this nowadays. And so you, as a composer, if you understand the systemic, and you know you have thematic music, you can sort of blend the two together, meaning that the repetition of the gameplay can be somehow felt differently because with the music, you're gonna apply different thematic every time on the system. Yes? Okay. One, yeah. Cutscene and in-game. I mean, that's so, I don't know, disappointing to see that people look at games and thinks, you know, think about cutscenes and music and emotions. Emotions, you hear this word a lot. Emotions in games. You know, oh yes, there are emotions. It's like saying there's water in the ocean. Music is emotion. Okay, no problem. But the thing is, the cutscenes and the in-game should never be separated in terms of experience. Like, where do I come from? What is this cutscene for? Where do I go? And maybe the music should start in-game, stop in the cutscene, or start in the cutscene and go after in-games. You don't know, okay? It's not like, oh, there is the cutscenes and the gameplay. It doesn't work like this. The pre-rendered, so now, and the real-time processed music. We're going to this planet, remember? And finally, where nobody will have any job anymore, when everything will be procedural, you know, I don't know exactly when, but soon enough. So, and this, once again, is for the developer and the composer to envision the game through a musical spectrum. Everything is being seen through a musical spectrum by both parties. So, finally, why bother? Since 99% of the games, you know, are being made with the sort of service provider attitude, why bother? Okay, I mean, I don't know why you're on Earth. I don't know why I am, okay? I'm trying to find why. So maybe it's, you know, for us to add some meaningful music. Meaning, you know, is something that is very rare nowadays. Film scoring, it's over. There is no more, okay? But in games, the thing is, they don't know. And since they don't know, you're free to do whatever you want. Do you get it? Like in film scores, when you do score a movie, people will be like, I'm not sure. And you have like 12 people saying to you what to write. And in the end, you're just like, okay, whatever. In games, they're like, oh, I don't know. Do whatever you want. That's, you know, that's something that me, that's why I don't do film scores. Because I'm like, what? I'm free to do. I mean, I went crazy on most of the soundtrack I did for games. Can you imagine going to London, record like Abbey Road, and screw up the whole recording with glitches for a movie? Like the guys and, you know, the executive in Hollywood, like, we're going to pay for that? And you're going to do this on that? No. No, that's not happening. But in games, they were like, oh, yeah, that's amazing. So you have a lot more freedom, creative freedom, to put more of yourself. So you should do it. You should put meaningful music, not like, oh, yeah, let's go. Oh, you know what I mean? Come on. You can put yourself, you know, into everything. And to extend the artistic vision, of course, because then, you know, it provides with some new and refreshing takes, hopefully. Then, you know, improve our craft using the latest technologies. There is one thing very important, music in games, is the technology. I mean, Simon started with it, you know, saying, like, it's technology, artistic, it's like hand in hand. And you have to embrace technology. if you're not like geeky about, you know, how you can use the technology, music for games, I mean, today is okay, but like in a few years, hopefully the young generation and even like the other ones, they will be so crazy about this that, you know, people will be so happy to work on this environment that those that don't follow up with the technology, it's like my parents about the internet. You know, it's like, yeah, come on, you can look up on the internet, but show me, you know. So, so anyways, so that's why you should embrace technology. You know, every new update of WISE is such an excitement. So now, ultimately, and that's what matters most, it's not about us. It's not about our music, okay? It's about them. Not the developer, but the gamers. It's for them we're doing this. I'm not here to pretend, oh, my music, you know, I'm a musician. I feel sometimes I need to write music, blah, 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 blah. No, no, it's not about this, okay? It's about them. And you have to focus on them. And to be them, to play the game you're scoring, you need to be the gamer. Because if somebody sends you over some videos, like when people experience video games on YouTube, yeah, they don't understand what's going on. Because you're like, you're watching the movie, okay, on YouTube, and you see this gigantic boss. It's wonderful. And you see the mountains, and you see all the, you know, the effects, and you're like, wow, this game's so beautiful, wow. And but the gamer is like, I'm gonna get you, I'm gonna get you. And he doesn't see, or she doesn't see anything but the life bar, you know, and the next perks. And it's like, and so you, as a composer, when you look at the picture, you know, if it's just a video, you may miss the point. The point is the, I don't know, maybe the sword that you just lost, or maybe, you know, the life or whatever. You need to experience it as, you know, gamers will. It's very important. So why bother is not safe, because that's the unknown. But I can tell you, I have never done, let's say, a hit game. You know, my best Metacritic has just came out. It's 77. See the reaction? Okay. Nothing above 90, ever, with me, ever. But if it's been 15 years. And you know, the last project, we went Abbey Road. The previous, it was like the musicians from the Pierre Boulez, you know, orchestra. The previous was the Brussels Philharmonic. Previous was like Boston Symphony. You see those names? It's big names. It's big money to get them involved. How can I get this? How is that possible that, you know, I'm not as famous or successful as some, you know, some other guys or girls. But still, you know, I get like those budgets because of the relationship, because of the approach, because the developers understand me because they saw that I understood them. And this relationship created this trust. Let's see how, you know, this is right then. Let's see how I do it once again with a video.
I am not the safe choice. The safe choice for you would be HHM. I believe, however, that I am the right choice.
Why?
That suit you're wearing, did you buy it off the rack?
Please don't tell me it looks like I did.
If it did, I wouldn't have asked. So why do you prefer a tailor-made suit? Because it fits you. And you alone, because each and every stitch was fretted over with you in mind. Either you fit the jacket, or the jacket fits you.
You can applaud. Come on. You see that, I mean, she's perfect, all right? I'm trying to say those things, but in a very sort of, you know, my own way. But it works, because they understand that what I have in mind is their games. Every one of them, you should ask them how much close we work together to provide with what we thought, Maybe we failed. Sometimes we do. Okay, I'm not saying we're doing the perfect thing, but at least we're a team and we're working together for one thing, a video game. So let's see how it applies, and let's get, you know, on this first planet. And so lately I've been working with Aardman. So for those who don't know, they made Wallace and Gromit, you know, recently Early Man, the movie. So they're like a big company for artistic things. And this game called 1111 Memories Retold is a sort of a tribute to the First World War I armistice. So I'm going to be describing a little bit about the game, and I want to tell you that this is the general approach, okay? It's the general approach, but I want to tell you how a little twist that we did that made a little difference. So basically in the game you have one character, it's Elijah Wood, he's called Harry, and he's a Canadian, and he's very naive and young, okay? And on the other hand, you have Kurt, it's Sebastian Kor, and he's a German, and he's a father, realistic father. So as you can see, right now, what I just did to you is what? I was just giving you the characters, and the context is like, it's World War I, they're gonna meet, and something's gonna happen, and no spoiler, blah, 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 buy the game. So the thing is, when you get those informations, you know, it's already something for you as a composer. Most composers stop here. It's like, okay, I get it. I'm gonna write the music. Good. Now, the thing is, you ask a little bit about the gameplay, and they're like, oh, you can switch from one to the next, like this. I'm like, what? They're like, yeah. You can go like from a, you know, Harry to Kurt, Kurt to Harry. And then I'm like, well, hold on. You can switch anytime? Now you're starting to be scared as a composer, because you know what it, you know, what's what it means. Like, you know? And they're like, oh, no. It's scripted. We will decide most of the time when you get to be Harry and Kurt. Okay, good. So, but, you know, that's where it starts. Because if they said, oh yeah, we can switch freely, then you have to compose the music in a way that you can, like, make something that is very seamless, okay? So, of course, there are so many options to do this layering, you know, approaching, whatever the solutions you have. But my point is that because of this switch, I should have written a different music because of the way it works. So now, you know, I'm just talking about, you're mostly composers here. So basically what was happening is like, okay, since it's mostly a film scoring because it's a narrative-driven game, there are no gameplay per se, you know those games, if I can tell it's games. So he was more melodic because the writers were like, when they were expressing about Harry, they were like, oh, he's very like naive and blah, blah, blah. So I was like, okay, melodic, horizontal. But Kurt is like German, and he's like very like grounded. So, you know, when they were doing this, I was like, oh yeah, harmony, okay? Feels right. So, of course, what I did is I was giving to Harry some G major flavor. And so for Kurt, thank you. You know, it's so easy. You know, that's my point. It is easy, okay? It is easy, but it is meaningful. You think about it, and you're like, okay, so by doing this, and you know that they're going to meet, and something's going to happen, and you know that you're going to write counterpoints with the melodies and the harmony, and everything will make sense on your own. They don't get to understand this. You're not like explaining them, oh, you see, the harmony makes this, and the melody, they don't understand this. This is your job, to enhance with music, you know, the game itself. So now I'm going to play a little like level just to show you. This is like nothing, let's say, magical. So you start with Harry, and you're going to switch to Kurt. And the thing is like, so G major, E minor, and we kept the same tempo, and it's the same 1-2-3 beat, okay? So it feels like it's sort of the same mood, because it's like the second level, and both of them are going to war. Harry by boat, and Kurt in train. Why is that bar first? So that's, you see, that would be wise. You have the, yes. So you see, it's like you have a lot of here segments, and it's just following the storyline, and it's the same with Kurt, and you know, they're just like the same tempo based and the signature. So we start with Harry.
And before I knew it, I was taking photos in the middle of the ocean. I'd never even left Canada, let alone been on a ship before. You could have fit Taylor's whole photography store in the front deck alone. I'd wake up early each morning to practice with my camera. We must have been close to shore that day. For the first time in weeks, I saw birds. The camera Julia gave me was marvelous, the best I'd ever used. I could even change the lens to see things close up. Photos on the boat were easy. I'd had more trouble with customers back home. But once we arrived, I didn't know what to expect. So, everyone said the Germans were crazy.
And so I'm on a train heading out of Germany, where I write to you now. It's not a comfortable journey, being on this train. For you, my darling, nothing changes. I will still be away from home. Only now, I will carry out my duties as an engineer on the front lines.
So anyways, so that's, you know, basically, that's the general approach with music. You know, it's like it's a cue and you go. So in Memories Retold, let's say that the music itself, since I knew it was so basic, I made a lot of meaningful music things. The soundtrack is on Spotify and everywhere. And by listening to the music, you don't have to play the game because everything is in the music in terms of storyline, because it's just a story. Now let's go to the next world. So I'm going to lose some people here, maybe. Okay? If you get lost, you raise your hand. So Vampire. So it's a game about a vampire, and it's in London in 1918, and the creative director was like, okay, this game is about talking to people, exploring, talking to people, exploring, fighting, exploring, talking to people, okay? And he said, I want to feel the sort of, you know, you're outside in London, it's sort of coldish, and then you get inside, so it's a little bit warmer, cozy, but then you start speaking with somebody, so I want these sort of dialogues to be more like intimate, either it's outside or inside. So basically, you have this sort of exteriors with dialogues, interiors with dialogues, and this. You don't know exactly when it's going to happen, you don't know, you know, anything. So me, as a composer, and as I know systems and all of this, I'm like, okay, how can I create something that feels what the creative director wants to do, and that feels that, musically speaking, it's interesting? So of course, we could have gone with layers and all of this, but it wouldn't be enough. The idea was like, so that's, once again, one idea out of every one of us. You know what I mean? Everyone should have a different idea, or maybe like converging to maybe some several same ideas, but at least there is not one idea. So the one that we took is that I wrote phrases rather than writing like a full score, okay? And those phrases would be played randomly, one after the other. And these phrases would be recorded by the, so it's a cello solo. So we would go like with like a big reverb for outside, with like cymbalum for inside, a little more piano, and the cello would play a little softer. And when you get to talk to somebody, it would be a different line, a different voice, and all of this, with the fact that it's phrases going from one to the next. So what it means is that, musically speaking, it sorts of reinvents, you know, the music, because those phrases are played randomly, okay? So you never know what's going to be next. And as you stay in this area for maybe 3 hours, and the cue, if you play it on the soundtrack, you know, this thing that people understand that is music for game, the cue is maybe 3 minutes or 4 minutes long for 3 hours. Are you kidding me? But nobody complained. Opposite. People were like, oh, the music. You know? So how did we do this? Basically, what you have, so this is not the final version, and it's the same with the game. I couldn't find the latest version, too many games. So you have here all the voices, the phrases, okay? So for external dialogue, you know, external exploration, then interior dialogues, interior exploration, and then you have if you're in dialogue or not, you know, depending on the situation, you have like this sort of switch. Well, it's a little technical. My point is that it's very organic, and we start thinking as an engine, but still it's more a player now than an engine. But let's see the result. So outside with big verb. Yeah, it's definitely not the final game. Looks better. So I'm going to talk to this guy.
Good evening, sir. I'm Dr. Jonathan Reed. I'm new here.
I've already heard about you, Dr. Reed. I'm Milton Hooks, the ambulance driver for this shithole of a hospital.
That's quite a blunt introduction, Mr. Hooks.
You can call me Milton. I like to speak my mind, Dr. Reed. Perk of the job. Don't judge me, and I won't judge you.
I'm not sure I understand what you're talking about.
Well, I'm no doctor, but I'm pretty sure a gun can't be used as a surgical instrument.
You have a keen eye. I learned to shoot during the war and have...
No need.
Okay, so you could hear that the cello that were like some was high, you
Goodbye,
know,
in
the high register. Now it's low register. Now I'm back outside. Listen, the register of the cello.
Perhaps I should have...
You see what I mean? Because if you have a dialogue with a high register cello, knowing that it's male speaking could, you know, have conflicts. So now I'm getting inside. So the phrases is still for the exteriors. We didn't want the music to be like so reactive, so you would feel. Now it's different.
Blood boil with the fever.
Daily routine.
See, it's like chamber now, sort of atmosphere, more cozy. And of course, the randomness of Wise picked the same cue, the same phrases as. So now I'm talking to this. Listen to the
Good
cello.
Good evening, nurse.
Good evening, doctor. I don't think we've been introduced yet.
So you have
My
the bass.
My name is Pippa Hawkins.
And now there's a new
and
phrase
I'm
on top.
Dr. Jonathan Reed.
Now.
Dr. Swansea has recently offered me a position in this hospital.
Well, it's a euphemism that your help will be appreciated, doctor.
Phrase.
Goodbye, Nurse Hawkins.
And now you're going back to interior. So no more cello, and then back. High register. Doesn't conflict with the dialogue. Back to the exteriors. Big verb. See, it's very seamless in a way. You don't feel it like, oh yeah, that's amazing. You know, nobody called me and be like, and was like, oh, what you did and blah, blah, blah. But it doesn't matter. What does matter is that it gives you this feeling of getting closer to people. Did you get it? You know, with the cello becoming like softer and, you know, so that was one of the ways we used music in Vampyr. Now, let's go a little like in the future. And let's talk about the engine. So the next thing, one of the systems in the game, so remember the systems, so something that's going to happen a lot of time in the game, that the creative director told me about is the embrace feature. So in the game, what happens is you're a vampire, and what you do is you get somebody, you talk to him or her, and you're like, oh, I'm going to suck your blood. But they're okay with this because you just... sort of spell on them or something. And they're like hypnotized, but you cannot bite them like in the streets like this. So what happens is like you need to take them to somewhere where you don't see them. And the what the creative director wanted is this. It's like you take them and it's like, oh, I'm gonna bite you. Oh yeah, I'm gonna bite you. Yeah, that's what he wanted to have, okay? In terms of feeling, okay? He did this to me. So, no, he didn't bite me. No, I mean, this. So I was like, okay, so you want the music to be very progressive in terms of intensity. So there are, once again, many ways of doing this, but there is one that few people get from Wise. So to give you the context, when you talk to people, what he wanted, once again, you know, I mean, he and I, it's a relationship, once again. It was like to use a choir. And what we were talking about, it's like, oh, that would be good to have the choir be like, you know, saying something. So in Gaelic, and it was like, Gaelic, and it was like this, like, vroom, dum. And then it was me, and I was like, so do you think it would be good to have like, vroom, dum, vroom, dum. Vroom dom, vroom dom, vroom dom, and blah. Okay, and he was like, oh yeah, if we can do this, that would be amazing. So now, you know, because I know Wise, once again, technology, I know that we can use MIDI. And MIDI, the beautiful thing about MIDI, although there are many aspects, but one of the beautifulest thing is the tempo. You can change the tempo. You know, it will not affect the file because there is no file. You're with me? Okay? So, you know, you all know Kontakt. I'm pretty sure everybody's using Kontakt here. I mean, composers. So it's a sampler, okay? And the sampler is just something that says, you know, the MIDI will trigger a sound, okay? And you go like, you know, do, mi, fa, si, do, okay? And the sampler will go along. But also, it's on the velocity. Like if you do soft, it goes like vroom dom. If you go strong, vroom dom. Okay? So what I did is I went to record the choir, asked them to do pianissimo, piano, mezzo piano, you know, all those things. And I created the Kontakt in Wise. And so what happens is there is one RTPC here from there that says, okay, so from here and there, the distance is that. So it's the gameplay programmer, and so the tempo will go from this value to that value, and the, you know, the RTPC will go like this, and everything. So there is a drone, so there is some RTPC like on the drone, and the choir and everything are reacting to this. So I'm just using Wise here. It's not in-game, but I'm faking the distance. So it's here. Vroom doom, all right? So you'll see this value. Listen to the choir and everything. You see how more intense it gets? So if I go back, it's not a volume on the voices, it's a recording. So now I'm going to play a little bit. So this last thing, you know, it never happens in the game that you teleport. It's just to show you how rock solid, bulletproof it is using MIDI. You didn't hear anything weird, you know, when I went like this, because of MIDI and the way you use MIDI in Wise. And now you start thinking as a composer that the writing you're doing is not exactly the same way as you used to in a DAW and printed everything. You need to think about the ability of Wise and to write depending on that. Still with me? Okay. And at the end, when you bite the guy, then you switch to the next container, and it's like this. Very uplifting game. So, and that's printed, okay? So as a composer and producer, because we're generally both, I mean, it's very rare. I don't know how many of you use a producer to produce your music for the music you're writing, but generally we do produce the music. So you need to sort of envision this and to be like, okay, I need to record that, I need to record this. You know, it's very important to prepare for the systems and the writing you did. Okay? So, it is time to go on this faraway planet where even the ship couldn't go at some point. So, I know that I have 5 minutes, okay? Yeah, 10, 5. It's a very complicated project, okay? On every aspect of the project. I was used to do AAA games, and I stopped because I felt that, you know, music in games in the AAA world was stuck into, like, this provider service, you know, sort of, okay, whatever, you know, open world with, like, this sort of very, let's say, music. I mean, open worlds are very difficult to do, and I'm back on AAA doing open world right now. It's very difficult, okay? But I needed to get off this sort of approach and to try different approach, like something. So I did Vampire, I did Get Even, I did 1111, I did three other games. And so just to practice things, to search, you know, to do some R&D on my own. And Get Even was, I mean, it's like when I did Remember Me, you remember in the morning, did you see like the branching? And I said to myself, never again, ever. But Get Even, you know, was there, and it was like the best moment for me to try something that I think should lead to some to be inspiring for you, I hope. So basically, I'm just going to explain to you what is Get Even. Okay, hold on. Get Even is a game that is happening in VR, but is not a VR game. Okay? So it pretends to be in VR, but you're experiencing yourself as a 2D game. Okay? So the whole approach was a VR game for me. And I was like, how do I do music in a VR game? Number one question. Number two question. The world of Get Even is somebody that is watching somebody else watching somebody else through VR. Okay? So you have layers of understanding. Okay? And the thing is, me with music, I was like, okay, can we have like background music that's like, oh, this is what's happening on screen? That was not possible, and that was not my goal in making this game. My goal is like, okay, what can we do so you feel the music is around you, VR or not? Because most people didn't play, I mean, this game is not in VR. And so the idea was like, can you hear the room tone here? You know, can you sing the room tone? I mean, some people will be like, okay, but there is a note here, okay? There is something, multiple notes actually. But what we were like is like, okay, we're gonna create room tones. Those room tones will be attached to the music. And this is why, because once again, meaningful. You need to be meaningful to the purpose of your game on both artistic and technology. So it's complicated to explain, I'm sorry. But the thing is, the game starts with when the main character goes to save a girl, but he knows that he's gonna die because he's re-experiencing this. But it's in his subconscious because he doesn't know that he's dead. So what we wanted to do is to make those room tones very like oppressive at some point, like to feel like oppressed and very bad. And so what happened is like there is a bomb at the end, and that's when the bomb explodes that he dies, okay? So there's a ticking bomb. And also, you know, he goes from room to room and get there. And so we wanted players to feel like overwhelmed by this. So the thing that we created is something that the music is being made by the environment. The environment is the music. So the room tones becomes drones, all in 3D, okay? Like the light bulbs, like these things, bzzz, music, okay? And in this morning, the wise meter, you know, that was used for pumping, you know, the side chaining. Instead of using this for a mixing aspect, I use this for creating music. Meaning that, well, I'm gonna play it for you. So bear in mind, everything you're gonna listen is in real time. Everything. So everything you heard is in real time. I know it's, I mean, it will require a full day for me to explain to you and to show you in WISE, okay? But the magic is that you can sync everything together using WISE, meaning that the light bulbs, the music, outsource, insource, MIDI, not MIDI, everything can be in sync. And it can be rendered in 3D or in 2D, and you can switch whenever you want. So the way you're gonna, number one, experience music is truly unique to video games, but truly you as composer, you're gonna do something that nobody else can do on other medium, because right now only in games you can do this, thanks to WISE Audiokinetic. You know? So let's see another example and I'll be done. So once again, relationship. The creative director was like, the girl that dies, supposed to die, she has, oh my God. So her dad created this device to read memories, okay? And she was used to practice piano, to practice violin, okay? She was a big lover of violin. So he, the father, would have recordings of his daughter playing, you know, rehearsing violin. They didn't know before meeting me that she was playing violin. It was because of our conversation. I was like, oh, that would be good to have violin. So what they did, you can see here, you're in her room. I don't know if you can see, but there is a violin here. Remember meaningful? That's exactly what I'm talking about. Everything is connected. And so what happened is like, the father takes the body of the dead guy to understand what happened and to sort of stimulate his body, he plays on the radio the music that he used to play in his office when this guy who was his right-hand guy would enter. So basically everything is connected. So what you're gonna experience is being this guy that is almost dead, listening is in his subconscious, like in a coma, to the radio that the other guy is playing for him. But at some point, he's getting a little weird about this. So that's the violin. So that's the father.
Cerebral link, patient number black 001. Pandora unit terminal.
You hear the music?
Would you like to commence archive data review, Dr. Ramsey?
Yes. Switch to Savant unit.
So it's coming from the computers, the music?
Begin the review. Oh, and hope. Violin.
Okay, now that's the father.
I used to hear it in my office. Remember?
It's not me playing, but there was a radio. So he's playing the music to the guy in coma. Now you're the guy in the coma in his own mind. Okay, that's fucked up, but sorry for the word, but couldn't say anything else. And he can hear, he can listen to the music. You know, and it's in the world. And did you see the heartbeat and everything?
I almost didn't see you there, sneaking around like a cat.
See, you see, you have the piano in the back, you have the drums here, you have the heartbeat in sync.
The party, he's on his way, he's on his way! You!
Mr. Black.
The drone. So now a little later in the game, so there is this door, and somebody's banging the door and saying, the party, music come this. So from this door, the party. Some other crazy guys. If you open this closet, they're going to change the lyrics to Puppet Man.
He's here!
Everything is in real time. Everything. And the recording of the string and the piano. See? It's all in sync with the drone. You know? And that's a little later in the game.
Why? What is all this? Can't y'all just leave me alone?
Save the king.
So anyways, it's a very weird game. Okay? But this is where, you know, the music becomes something completely different from what you guys are used to. You know what I mean? The way we use music in games can be so different using all the tools we have if we look at the tools for what they are. And Wise is one of those tools. It's more than just a player. It's an engine, and you want to take advantage of this to express your own artistic view. And you can do this. So, basically, music for game is the relationship between a composer and a developer engaged in a team spirit. It's very important. Basically, that's without that, you can't provide with the best work. Then it's just not a passive, you know, response to some states, but it's actively reacting to the engine. Engine, it's very important. Also, it's meaningful to its own purpose. Once again, the game. You know, and the technology behind the game. And finally, never forget, music for games has yet a language to be created. Nobody knows how to make a game. Nobody knows how to make music for games. Thank you. Oh, we have questions?
Hey, good talk. Nice. Question about the synchronizing multiple 3D sources. Do you have to do that all under one parent object, or can you?
No, you can't, because they are like in the world in 3D, so you have to have each object together. So,
how do you keep a global tempo?
Well, that's the thing. You know, I was discussing with Audiokinetic at the time, and this is why I didn't do this on a AAA game, because they were like, yeah, you can start events at the same frame on several objects, and it should be in sync. Remember this conversation?
So that's the most official, unofficial feature of Wise, where we still not guarantee it, don't do it, but if you play multiple events on the same frame, it's gonna work.
Yeah, so that works. I mean, it worked like a charm. This, what you saw, is just like the tip of the iceberg. I went to create like more than 17 systems that are, you know, as crazy as they can get. And it's very demanding in terms of Wise features, but Wise, and I was very amazed by this, you know, it's very solid. It kept on Xbox, PlayStation 4, and PC.
So those are all still interactive music objects that did have a tempo. They just happen to be the same tempo, and you just happen to start them at the same time.
Yeah, you know, basically you have a master, let's say you have the master playlist. Okay, and this master playlist is being played in the known world, okay, like 2D, okay? And what you do is you kind of want to start this master with like the other guy that is on, let's say, the door, the slamming door with the MIDI and all of this. You start those together, but the states that are acting and saying, oh, go from this, you know, segment to that segment can happen here too, okay? So you need to create the same sort of hierarchy, but then they also can have their own states, you know, each thing. So you can be very, like, open to craziness. Yeah.
Very cool.
Yeah, no more questions. So there is one there. Okay. Is there? No, too bad. No, it was just like, hey. Okay, thank you.
But something that Olivier mentioned, I think, in London 2 weeks ago, is he's using a lot of MIDI ticks just to get a tempo, to kick in the sidechaining system, and the click itself is muted on a parent bus elsewhere, but that gives him a clock to do sidechaining on other objects, other buses, and that's another way. And that's how we got all the lighting buzzing and things like that. So that's a cool thing. And that's the thing in Montreal 2 years ago. He was there, was trying to do that, and said, yeah, use sidechaining, and you can like go in this direction, and 2 years after, yeah.
Yeah, you can go very crazy. The thing was, what were you talking about? You see,
side chaining with the click with
MIDI. The side chaining, click, but yeah. Just before, you said
tempos.
You
see, yeah, the concurrent the music.
Yes.
Montreal.
The MIDI, the tempo. Music. I mean, as composers, I don't know how you feel about this, but I hate click. Like, you know, it kills music sometimes. I mean, unless you're doing something groovy or anything. But, you know, with this sort of classical music, it's very complicated to obtain a very much expressive music with a click. So what we did is we recorded without click. The live orchestra, I didn't show much of that because, you know, it's too many things. But there is a live orchestra on top of this without click, like for some cues, and some do have click. But the thing is, to have the game itself be in sync without click, you know, the MIDI is golden, because what happens is like the MIDI is triggering. So what I did is like in Nuendo or Cubase, at the time it was Cubase, I was like creating like this track and, you know, finding the beats and putting like a MIDI note to each beat, and I would use this in Wise as the click track. And now everything was in sync, you know, with this, although it was not a steady click. So once again, a lot of things can happen in Wise. Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much, Olivier.